Hello everyone, it's me again, Elisabetta Manea from University UAB of Venice. In this module, we are going to talk about the ecosystem-based management, principles, tools, and methods. People have been exploiting marine and coastal ecosystems for centuries, and for this reason today, many of them are in degraded condition and live an overall decline in their diversity and productivity. The ability of the oceans to maintain their diversity and productivity, thus providing a wide array of benefits to people, are being compromised. Because of this situation, the ecosystem-based management of the marine and coastal space and resources is a necessity. Ecosystem-based management is an integrated approach to management that considers the entire ecosystem, including humans. The goal of EBM is to maintain an ecosystem in a healthy, productive, and resilient condition so that it can provide the services humans want and need. EBM differs from current approaches that usually focus on a single species, sector, or activity or concern. It considers the cumulative impacts of different sectors. Ecosystem-based management is an approach that goes beyond examining single issues. Instead, it recognizes ecological systems for what they are, uncountable elements that interact with each other through important and complex ecological processes. Because humans depend on this array of ocean and coastal functions and processes, EBM recognizes that our welfare and the health of the environment are strongly linked. Thus, the marine and coastal ecosystems have to be managed sustainably. This means managing them in a way that acknowledges their complexity, the connections among them, their links with the land, fresh water, and the atmosphere, as well as how people interact with them. These are examples of both poor and well-managed city development. If the city expands with no consideration of the coastal and marine space, without restriction, the result will be a hardened shoreline, natural habitats fragmentation, and the disappearance of the green space. And potentially, unregulated land and coastal activities will participate to these habitats' deterioration. As a result, environmental conditions will be compromised, as well as many human activities, especially the recreational ones. On the contrary, if the city decides to invest in urban planning by including consideration of the surrounding coastal and marine ecosystems, all this will not happen. The green space will be maintained and human impacts will be limited. For instance, the natural shoreline will be conserved thanks to a buffer between development and the coast. Thus, the residents of the city will continue to enjoy the coastal and marine space, and the water will be clean and productive. Management must consider the great connectivity of marine ecosystems. This means that human uses have to be managed at a scale that encompasses the entire marine and coastal ecosystems, rather than scales defined by the existing jurisdictional boundaries. Thus, one of the most important aspects of EBM is that it is fundamentally a place-based approach, where the ecosystem represents the place. Moreover, EBM underpins ecosystem-based adaptation, helping vulnerable natural communities to cope with climate change impacts. Many are the official strategies and regulations that call for the ecosystem-based approach at both global and European levels. For example, the Convention of Biological Diversity, which aims at supporting the conservation of biodiversity and the sustainable use of its components at global levels, calls for the ecosystem approach in its Principle 5. Again, the Marine Strategy Framework Directive, which aims to protect more effectively the marine environment and its resources across Europe, and to achieve the good environmental status of the European's marine waters by 2020, asks for an adaptive management based on the ecosystem approach. Finally, the Maritime Spatial Planning Directive, with its aim of creating a common framework for the building of the maritime spatial plans at the European level, invites the member states to apply the ecosystem approach to promote the sustainable use of the marine space and resources. The Convention of Biological Diversity embraces 12 main principles to pave the way to the application and implementation of the ecosystem-based approach. Principle 1 says that the objectives of management of land, water, and living resources are a matter of societal choices. In fact, many societies view ecosystems in such economic terms, from the perspective of their cultural and society needs. Indigenous people and local communities living on the land are important stakeholders, and their rights and interests should be recognized. Thus, both cultural and biological diversity are central components of the ecosystem approach. Principle 2 says that management should be decentralized to the lowest appropriate level. This will lead to greater efficiency and equity. Management should involve all stakeholders and balance the local interests with that of the wider public. Principle 3 takes into account that ecosystem managers should consider the effects of their activities on adjacent and other ecosystems. This is true because management interventions in ecosystems often have an unknown or unpredictable effect on other ecosystems, especially in the marine environment where concrete barriers are mainly absent. Principle 4, recognizing potential gains from management, says that there is usually a need to understand and manage the ecosystem in an economic context. Any such ecosystem management program should reduce those market distortions that adversely affect biological diversity, align incentives to promote biodiversity conservation and sustainable use, internalize costs and benefits in the given ecosystem to the extent feasible. Principle 5 says that conservation of ecosystem structure and functioning in order to maintain ecosystem services should be a priority target of the ecosystem approach. Principle 6 says that ecosystem must be managed within the limits of their functioning, in considering the likelihood or ease of attaining the management objectives. Attention should be given to the environmental conditions that limit natural productivity, ecosystem structure, functioning diversity. Principle 7 says that the ecosystem approach should be undertaken at the appropriate spatial and temporal scales. Boundaries for management will be defined on the basis of the habitats and biological diversity, which are characterized by numerous ecological interactions, and connectivity must be taken into consideration. Principle 8, recognizing the varying temporal scales and lag effects that characterize ecosystem processes, says that objectives for ecosystem management should be set for the long term. Principle 9 says that management must recognize that change is inevitable. In fact, ecosystems change, species composition and community structures change naturally in time. Thus, management should adapt these changes. Principle 10 says that the ecosystem approach should seek the appropriate balance between an integration of conservation and use of biological diversity. And Principle 11, that the ecosystem approach should consider all forms of relevant information, including not only the science-based ones, but also the indigenous and local knowledge, innovations, and practices. Finally, Principle 12 says that the ecosystem approach should involve all relevant sectors of society and scientific disciplines. Most problems of environmental management are complex, embracing many interactions, side effects, and implications. And for this reason, there is the need of different expertise and stakeholders at multiple levels. Here we have the 5 core elements that you can find in the JUCN guidelines of 2011. These elements highlight five main aspects, which are fundamental in the context of ecosystem-based management. These are the environmental connectivity, which should be incorporated in any planning process, the socio-ecological aspect that arises when we talk about ecosystem services. We will talk better later in relation with ecosystem services. Sustainability is fundamental and implies that the impacts of human activities should be limited, avoiding detrimental effects on the environment. Ecosystem-based management should manage multiple objectives, meaning that should be participative by involving different stakeholders. And finally, EBM should be adaptive, which means that it should learn from the experience and embracing the change. In addition to these five core elements, many others are the identified key principles which represent the foundation of ecosystem-based management. Coming back to the definition of EBM, the objective of EBM is indicated and is to maintain the ecosystems in a way they can provide the services humans want and need. When we talk about the services human needs, we talk about the ecosystem services. There are several definitions of ecosystem services that mainly give them a common meaning. All these definitions include both environmental and socioeconomic aspects. In fact, they talk about ecosystem functions, nature, biotic and abiotic processes. Contemporarily, benefits and direct and indirect contributions to human well-being are cited. Ecosystem services, indeed, represent the link between nature and human being. Many are the classification approaches of ecosystem services. The Millennium Ecosystem Assessment is one of the most recognized. It classifies ES in supporting, provisioning, cultural, and regulating services. These services are also divided in direct and indirect services. For example, fish resources are a direct benefit and a provisioning service. This benefit has a defined economic value. On the contrary, cultural and supporting services are mainly indirect and not easily monetary valued. For this reason, they are usually not considered and underestimated during ES assessment processes, despite they are fundamental for human well-being. The economics of ecosystems and biodiversity, TEEB, clearly divide the functions and structures of ecosystems from the benefits for humans. And the Common International Classification of Ecosystem Services, CICES, does not separate the habitat services or supporting services from the regulating ones. Developing an ecosystem services perspective is important for planners and managers when establishing priorities for management. Priorities can be determined by focusing on those areas that deliver the greatest amount of ecosystem services, or the ones with the highest value. This is an example of assessment and mapping of supporting ecosystem services in the Adriatic Sea, where through the use of spatial information, it was possible to identify more and less effective areas in ecosystem services provisioning. And again, coming back to the definition of ecosystem-based management, it is highlighted the multi-sectoral approach of EBM and the importance of consider the cumulative impact. The human activities that take place within an ecosystem often overlap with each other, and their impacts can be intensified as a result. By examining such cumulative impacts, it is possible to assess the pressures that derive from the human activities and that affect the environmental components which constitute the ecosystems. The cumulative impacts or cumulative effects assessment allows to assess the total effect of various human actions on multiple environmental components of one or more ecosystems to orient the ecosystem-based management of a natural space and resources. This is an example made again in the Adriatic Sea, where the most impacted marine areas, which are the dark red ones, have been identified in the first figure. In this case, uncertainty has been incorporated in the analysis. Uncertainty is fundamental to consider when part of the knowledge is lacking when dealing with ecosystem management. When uncertainty is high, in fact, ecosystem-based management should apply the precautionary principle by recognizing the absence of knowledge and anticipating and avoiding excessive pressures on the environment. The need to capture the complexity of the natural and especially the marine ecosystems and all the ecological processes that lead to their functioning is challenging. For this reason, the adoption of the multi-criteria analysis is of great help to deal with uncertainties about current or future impacts derived from both human uses and natural change. The multi-criteria analysis provides a systematic and transparent approach that increases objectivity. In fact, the multi-criteria analysis supports the building of alternative scenarios, starting from the goal of the plan and of ecosystem-based management, through the adoption of multiple criteria, considering different alternatives and thus orienting the most informed management decisions and actions. This is an example of multi-criteria analysis application. Here, a four-stage process has been developed based on the consecutive analysis of hazard, exposure, vulnerability, and risk affecting the marine environment. This risk-based methodology allows the evaluation of different risks, orienting decision makers in finding strategies and solutions to the excessive pressures the marine environment is facing. Here you can find all the references that were cited in this module. I invite you to deepen the themes we have addressed in this module.